Good morning, my name is Elizabeth Moore, and my research focuses on invasive plant proliferation and persistence following field treatments in on-Juniper woodlands. And first of all, I'd like to thank Dr. Grant, Dr. Koop, Dr. McGee, and three undergraduate research assistants, Paige, Aaron, and Marcel. I would not have been able to accomplish any of this without them. So, on-Juniper woodlands cover an expansive part of the American West. However, they're still relatively misunderstood. In the past century, they've been heavily impacted by human development and management, and today they face the complex impact of climate change as well. Some studies indicate that with the absence of fire and other natural disturbances, this has resulted in increased tree density and encroachment into grassland patches. And the matrix of woodland and grassland patches provides valuable habitat for wildlife such as mule deer, elk, desert cottontail, pinyon jays, Clark's nutcrackers, just to name a few. Managing problematic invasive plants in these ecosystems is also a dominant concern for land managers. While many communities realize that these plants are likely here to stay, they still may pose a threat to forest and watershed health. For instance, they may increase the risk of wildfire spread, they reduce suitable habitat and forage for native wildlife and domestic livestock, and they can increase erosion in riparian areas. Local communities are left to, with the need to replace these ecosystem functions and often bear the brunt of these expensive treatments and management costs. So field treatments are designed to thin tree density for forest restoration projects by means of mechanical methods, prescribed fire, and chemical methods. This project specifically addresses the use of hydrox treatments and hand-thin methods. Hydrox treatments involve the use of heavy machinery, and they are restricted to low slopes and ridges where these machines can be safely accessed. They're the most economically feasible, but they do not necessarily mimic a natural disturbance, such as fire. Treatments are often designed to address multiple social and ecological objectives, including wildfire protection, wildlife habitat improvement, and grazing and forage improvement. However, studies indicate that more site-specific research is necessary to determine if they're suitable in meeting long-term objectives. So this project is part of a larger joint fire science-funded project that assesses the impacts of fuel treatments on understory composition and avian community composition and fire behavior in on-Juniper woodlands. The question that I wanted to address is how effective are they in terms of meeting the long-term ecological goals associated with invasive plant management? Some studies indicate that they may meet the short-term management goals, but not necessarily the long-term implications of these treatments at a landscape scale. So a disturbance such as a hydrox is not analogous to a natural disturbance regime and may create an environment suited for invasive plant succession and treatment areas. So presumably, invasive plant cover in treated plots will be higher, mostly in the hydrox treatments. I also hypothesize that in field treatment areas, you would expect to find lower tree cover, higher woody debris ground cover, and higher annual grass and forb cover. So this study took place on the Bureau of Land Management Royal Gorge Field District, which covers about 700,000 acres in Arkansas River Valley. It's largely dominated by pinyon juniper woodlands, mostly two-needle pinyon, Rocky Mountain juniper, and one-seed juniper. And since 1998, the area has undergone over 300 field treatments in the form of hand thinning or hydrox. The treatment, the sites that were sampled in this research range in elevation from 1,855 meters to 2,500 meters. So during the 2015 field season, we visited 29 paired treatment and control sites. 24 of these were hydrox methods, 5 were hand thin treatments, and at each of these sites we have 4 treatments and 4 controls for a total of 232 point locations. We characterized vegetation communities using standard vegetation monitoring protocols. We use point line intercept methods to record ground cover, aerial cover for live vegetation, and tree and shrub canopy cover over 1.37 meters. This gives us a total of 102 points at each plot. And we also recorded presence-absence data within 100 square meters around at the plot. And finally, we took photo points to establish valuable visual representations that may be used in future monitoring. So statistical tests were used to analyze the data and indicate trends between dependent and independent variables. The data was tested against normality assumptions in order to determine the appropriate test. And due to the high variability in the data, we decided to go with a non-parametric analysis test called the Kruskal-Wallis test. This test is used to determine significant differences between two or more groups of an independent variable. We also use non-metric multidimensional scaling analysis, which is a multivariate technique to characterize relationships between plant community composition, canopy cover, ground cover, topography, climate, and other site characteristics. All of these were performed using R, a programming language and software environment for statistical computing. So the presence-absence data found 208 plant species from 53 families. The data was divided into Hydrax treatment and controls and Hansen treatment and controls. And then furthermore, it was analyzed looking at vegetation cover and ground cover data. So I analyzed vegetation community data by looking at all live vegetation cover, annual and perennial characteristics, the activity status, and lifeline characteristics of all the species found on the point intercept cover depth. Mean values for many of these variables were considerably different in the Hydrax treatments as opposed to the Hansen treatments, which only had significant differences in graminoid shrub treatment. The Kruskal-Wallis tests indicate that statistically significant correlations between Hydrax treatments and vegetation cover in almost all variables analyzed were significant in the Hydrax treatments as opposed to the Hansen treatments, which only differed in the tree cover, which is what you'd hope to find in a forest thinning project. I want to share some results from the ordination analysis for this project, which was completed with the help of Dr. Koop. Ordination analysis revealed major shifts in plant community composition with dual treatments, and a simple way of interpreting these graphs is to say that the sites that are closer together on the graph are more similar in species composition than those that are distributed further apart. So the control sites are represented with white, Hansen is yellow, and mastication or Hydrax is blue. NMS1 on this bottom axis represents a shift between untreated controls and treatments. And then NMS2 is related to local topographic shifts from warmer to cooler aspects and elevations using heat load index, mean annual temperature, and mean annual precipitation. In this first graph showing tree canopy cover, NMS1 is negatively correlated with tree canopy cover, which is great because the data proves that these dual treatments are effective in reducing tree density. This second ordination graph also shows significant relationship between introduced species composition and treatment, and it even more strongly correlated along NMS2, the axis associated with the site characteristics. In both of the graphs, the Hydrax treatments showed the greatest dissimilarity from controls, and the Hansen sites are kind of sprinkled in the middle positions of the graph. The influence of the topographic site characteristics influence on introduced species in this case may imply that Hydrax treatments at warmer locations are more susceptible to invasion by non-native plant species. So I also wanted to target five introduced plant species for analysis. Cheatgrass, mullein, Russian thistle, Paul's humble mustard, and Canada thistle, which are all also found in the Gunnison Basin. In hydroxide sites, significant relationships between mullein and Russian thistle and tall tumble mustard exist between treatment, whereas Hansen sites did not produce any significant results. For ground cover, bare ground is considered bare soil, rock, lichen, or gravel. Litter includes needles, duff, and leaf litter. Woody debris includes wood and wood chips of all sizes. In hydroxide sites, the bare ground and woody debris had significant relationships to treatment, whereas Hansen, again, did not have any of those significant findings. So findings from this research conclude that there are significant correlations between treatment projects and understory composition. Many more undesirable effects are found in the hydrox treatments as opposed to Hansen treatments. Vegetation cover analysis showed treatment effects introduced species composition more strongly in hydrox sites. And the ordination results suggest that topographic differences may also be a major factor in determining the abundance and proliferation of the species. Ground cover analysis indicates that there's higher woody debris correlated with hydrox treatments, which begs the question of whether treatments are effective in addressing wildfire resiliency and safety objectives in some of the treatment areas. In terms of the limitations of the studies, there's practically endless ways to use the data to gain a better understanding of land management in on-Juniper woodlands, possibly adding more Hansen sites to increase data related to Hansen treatment effect on understory composition. My project, is the first major analysis of the project, and there's other research underway related to avian habitat, remote sensing, fire behavior, and fire behavior post-treatments. Still, more research opportunities exist to better understand the influence of the treatment projects. So comprehensive research should focus on interactions of land use policy and development of biological community composition and health. Next steps include using a multivariate framework to incorporate transect level variation and landscape level variation among the sites. Results from this study imply that while Hansen fuel treatment methods may be consuming, costly, and resource intensive, they may be an effective alternative to hydrox methods in on-Juniper woodlands. So with the complex and compounding impacts of climate change and the influence of invasive plants, we face the need to address these issues for wildfire safety objectives in an expanding wildfire-urban interface zone. Understanding the forest dynamics in on-Juniper woodlands is imperative for creating resilient forests and healthy wildlife populations, healthy watersheds, and successful ecosystem functions. The task of managing invasive species in these novel ecosystems must be a major component of land management. Proactively anticipating changes in forest dynamics in a future full of uncertainties is essential. The use of adaptive management, long-term budgeting and planning, continuous monitoring, and using science-based research to inform decision-making is crucial. And that, thank you for your time, and I can answer any questions.
Started out, you had a slide up that had one of your, I guess, focal areas was grazing. Was this grazing ranchers grazing, or is it
all on public land? So it's on BLM, and I don't have specific grazing data related. So that's one of the potential next steps that a researcher could look at.
So you're talking about grazing leases.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
I might miss this, but how old were these treatments? Did you scale all across?
From 1998, they started doing doing these treatments, and there's been 300 since then. I think the sites that were sampled go back to 2004.
So they were all taken from the same year, or did you try multiple years?
There were multiple years. Yeah. And that's another thing that I would have liked to have time to look at was timing since treatment and how that affects these story compositions.
Sounds like you collected an enormous amount of data.
Yes.
So congratulations for getting it all together. I'm sure you couldn't do all of the analyses that you wanted to. What else would you want to explore, and what do you think would be interesting to look at that you weren't able to?
I think like the timing since treatment, that would have been huge. And then also maybe even adding in some prescribed fire plots to see what the differences between that kind of treatment would be. Some of the sites definitely had burn scars in them, but I don't have the data on when those fires happened or anything, so getting that kind of information would be useful, I think. There's a lot more questions I have.
Yeah, I was wondering, in regards to your data gathering and the transects, were all the transects the same length? And did you have the same points for every transect? And what were some obstacles you encountered in gathering the data using the transect method, and how did you overcome any obstacles, if there were any?
So there were three transects for a total of 102 points. They were about 30 centimeters intervals along a 10.2 meter transect. I would say biggest challenges were not knowing what some of the plants are in some of the early stages, especially. And then, it's always hard also to determine the right interval, because in a lot of the control sites, we really didn't hit that much live vegetation, whereas the treatment sites had a lot of vegetation. So, I think 30 centimeters is okay, but the more data, the better, probably, so.
Why did you choose 30 centimeters?
I wanted at least 100 points, and that is just what it ended up to be. We didn't want to start right at where the tape was placed, so we started at 30 centimeters, and then I think there were, it's been 34 points on each transect.
Any other questions? Let's go into the panel discussion.